everybody. I'm here with Mel from Zen Studios, or aka www.zenstudios.com. These folks made a lot of lovely pinball games, as well as, you know, various things providing. Now, today, Mel has a little bit to talk about with a little bit of a, I would consider a little bit of controversy. I would consider it a little obscure controversy, I mean, either way. But I'm giving Mel the room to talk and discuss the situation between his company, and, well, Team Meat and Microsoft and all those good stuff. But all right, without further ado, it's over to you, Mr. Mel.
Okay, cool. Thanks, man. yeah, just a little background on who I am, I guess. Mel Kirk with Zen Studios. My formal title of this small company is I'm like VP of marketing and PR, but mostly just chief code distribution dude, and send out a lot of promo code to give away a lot of stuff on Twitter. So, and also beyond that, handle a lot of relations between first parties like Microsoft and Sony, Nintendo now. We're getting into Apple and Android and all that. But anyway, I guess, you know, like the crux of our conversation today is focusing on a good experience with Microsoft, whereas recently there's been a lot of hate directed towards Microsoft in terms of, you know, like, people saying that they screwed them over, or that they didn't feel love from them, or the number of things. Even recently, another first party claimed that Microsoft blocks creativity to disguise their lack of hardware power, which is crazy. But anyway, our experience with Microsoft has been very positive. It's been awesome. We felt like we've been partners with them. They really helped out on Pinball FX 2. The game would not be what it is today without their input and their help. And it was a long, positive experience. And we continue to this day to have a great relationship with them. So when I hear people complaining and saying that they're terrible, it really just raises my eyebrows. And it makes me want to kind of speak up and to say, hey, it's not all bad. Like, just because one company says it's all bad and everyone wants to cover the controversy and wants to promote the headline about, you know, we almost died during development. I mean, most game developers work crazy schedules, so that's, you know, they're not alone there, but it takes a lot of hard work to get a game out. But, you know, it's not that all experiences are bad, and Microsoft has a lot of good things to offer indie developers and people who, you know, are making games.
Yeah, that's very true. I mean, it's like blood, sweat, and pixel there. It's just like you'll see a bunch of the independent games, like in that, you know, little bracket on the arcade there, where you see like these little games, like I made a game of zombies in it and all that. I mean, all those folks actually do bust a tail end. I mean, sometimes, you know, they just kind of sit there and be like, okay, I'll make a quick game, make it really simple, publish it. I mean, Microsoft, to give this open medium for some people to allow to do this is kind of nice. I mean, I ain't going to bash Sony for saying that they don't do that, because they probably have something in the works for that. I just haven't seen too much for that yet. And as for Nintendo, you know, beyond the eStore that they have, I could just honestly say, though, so far Microsoft's been really open for people to be creative. I mean, I haven't really seen too much lack thereof. I mean, exception to a couple of clones of Minecraft on that
yeah.
On the indie. Those are okay, but...
Yeah, you're totally right. And then you have to remember with Xbox and XBLA in particular, is that these guys have figured out a really good formula for quality content. And it's one of the – I really feel like it's pioneering digital distribution. Like XBLA and Steam are definitely pioneers, because you can sell a game for 10 or 15 bucks, you know, 800 or 1,200 points. And you're usually going to get quality content there. Like there's – really strict barrier to entry in place to make sure that it's only quality content, and that's got to be respected. I mean, it would be, I feel like it'd be terrible from a business perspective, and because I play a ton of games too, so from a consumer perspective, if all of a sudden every game known to man is up there and there's no gateway for quality, I mean, we all want to see quality games.
Yeah, that's very true. I mean, you'll have a lot of people say that Microsoft's mostly suits that just publish what they think is popular. For example, they'll say Halo is the only be-all, the end-all, which I don't really see that too much on the console. I see they try to open it up with other games out there, but you know, most people kind of take the side of the FPS, which is, you know, that's just what sells at this point. But it's not too bad looking at the arcade perspective, too. A lot of people buying a lot of arcade-based games, like pinball games, pardon the pun, and, you know, just mini golf. And it just really, it's really nice to see people still be able to dive into arcade games and still have that open optimism towards, you know, games of that nature. I mean, keeping it simple, having that challenge build up over time. I mean, it's nice to see an FPS game, you know, do successful. Don't get me wrong, I play a couple myself, but it's, you watch some of these FPS games and sometimes they kind of be the same thing over and over, the same layout. With most indies, they just go, okay, we'll make a game kind of like that, but we'll do it differently. And, you know, that's, it's really nice seeing people try that.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's plenty, like, the awesome thing about digital distribution is that there's plenty of places to put any game that is created these days. And at the end of the day, though, quality content is going to rise to the top, and beta content is going to rise to the top. And that's how you'll make a name for yourself. And, I mean, let's be honest, Super Meat Boy was a really, really good game. And now I get that, like, Team Meat couldn't do everything that they wanted to do with the game. You know, maybe there were some deadlines and things like that in place, but at the end of the day, it's still a very good game, and they've done very well there. So I mean, and there's other studios, like more studios than not share this opinion, and, you know, I can name a few, and I'm at liberty, you know, they're totally authorized to do so, but we're just sitting here kind of with our mouths open, like, why are these guys keep repeating this message of negativity, and why do they keep trying to bash Microsoft? It's just, it's getting old, like, it's gone on since GDC of last year. Our game and Twisted Pixels game, Comic Jumper, we were both part of the Game Feast promotion, and we got the same marketing, we got the same promotion as Super Meat Boy. In fact, Super Meat Boy is really the poster child for that whole entire campaign. So if you want to talk, you know, down to details, they probably got more than any of us. But we all had to work hard to get the game done. We all had to work hard to promote it. And at the end of the day, like, you know, they seem to be the guys who feel like they got the short end of the deal. But as far as to what level that they claim is just kind of like, you know, I don't know all the detail, but none of us have had that same experience to at all, not even close.
Yeah, that's kind of like that old saying, have your cake and eat it too kind of thing. But I mean, Super Meat Boy is doing really successful to a point. I mean, they're doing quite well. I mean, I guess I'm not going to push them down at all. That isn't for me to say at all. So, I mean, I enjoy the game. And I think it's good. And, you know, their success so far, I think, is good. And I'm just going to ignore their frustrations, I assume.
Yeah, totally. I guess, like, you know, if you want to put it all in one sentence or one phrase, it's just that not every experience on XBLA is negative for indie development. And don't let one situation frame your perspective. And I think hopefully we can get the story out that it's not all bad, and that I actually think there's more good than bad, but the good stuff doesn't draw the headlines.
Yeah, I mean, it's controversy, I think, that really sells a newspaper. Like, they'll just, like, you'll see a bunch of tabloids,
yeah,
and all,
no,
that, and
absolutely.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah, like, I don't know why just now. I just thought of a Lady Gaga pinball machine, but I just started chuckling in my head. No, sorry.
Yeah, that would be controversial.
I would hate to get the high score in that game. Oh, no, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, no, and look, I mean, we're over here, you know, we make a really good pinball game. We've made other types of games. Like, we're coming along as a studio and as a company. And it's better for all of us to, like, be positive about things and not harp on people or try to cause controversy to get coverage. And, like, we don't need to be controversial, and I don't need to be making all these claims to get our game covered. Like, we do just fine, and we sell just fine. It's just kind of, I was at this breaking point the other day when that Indie Games podcast came out and the Gama Sutra piece came in. It's just like, man, Microsoft's been so cool to us. Like, someone needs to stand up and say it. And it's very easy and popular to jump on the hate bandwagon. And I just say, you know what? We had positive experience. There's other guys who have it as well. So, there's two sides to it.
Exactly. When you're in the independent circuit, especially starting out fresh, it is going to be a high risk. And I can't say this from, like, personal perspective, but I can just see it's a really high risk, and it can be a high reward depending on how you get in there just at the right time. But it's really a huge risk, really, like publishing something. You got to make sure people like it and all that. And it's just, some people just need to stay positive. If you stay positive, promote and be very, you know, positive about your product, that's what's going to sell to people. You just got to be very positive and work with some of the people that, you know, like your product, obviously. You just got to be like, so you like this, we'll keep that and put it in the sequel, you know, that kind of thing. But
you just hit on a really important point, and it's something that I think the industry struggles with, and it's probably one of the main reasons why you don't see more innovation, is that it's risky. And to try something new costs a lot. It's an opportunity cost. And hell, if you put out a bad game, like, you've hurt your brand, you've hurt other future games that you release, people are going to question them more. And so that's why, you know, it's who's going to take the risk and execute on the first time doing that gameplay mechanic or the first type of game in that genre. And so everybody tries to take, you know, 80% or 90% of what's worked before and add 10% of what's never been done and test the waters. And, okay, we did that good. Now we can keep going a little bit further. And it's just, you know, the fear is there from big publishers. And that's why you've got these indie guys. We're like, screw it. We don't have anything to lose. We're just going to do what we want to do and work really hard at it and see what happens.
Yeah, I can't agree with you more with that, actually. It's just people, I don't know, they just expect too much out of things. And I don't know, it's just kind of a silly thing. For me, I always stay optimistic when I, like, for example, sort of like a side topic, I when I review things, I don't look at the company as a whole. Like, I just kind of look at the game first. Then I look at the company and say, if this game was good, this game was good. You know, that's all I can say.
Mm-hmm.
I can't say, like, South Peak will always put the greatest game out there, but they certainly put out a couple head turners, though. I mean, that company, I think, gets really bashed down on. It's because of, Two Worlds. That game, a lot of people had a lot of negative criticism about. I mean, some points I can agree with. Yeah, there's some points that need to be improved on, but the sequel came out. It was a heck of a lot better.
Yeah, no, the sequel was very good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess, you know, with the new kind of publishers that are coming up, guys who publish digitally, we control our own destiny. We don't need it to be in a box to sell a game, and we can ship when the game is done. I think that we're a little focused on brand right now. We feel like it's our opportunity to put a stamp on something and call it our own and help build a brand and build a, you know, a company out of it. So I think we're a little more worried about putting out something that isn't well received, because then you're like, oh crap, we just shot ourselves in the foot, you know? We don't have the huge marketing budgets to spin things or to buy, you know, advertising, and it's a completely different game.
Yeah, with digital distribution, it's really much more the same, just a word of mouth kind of thing, as well as, you know, you got the statistics kind of like an Xbox and PS3 will show like those star ratings and whatnot, and it'll be like, this is like a 4.5 star, and then, you know, that the feedback from the community, like, who buy these games and all that, I think that's the big margin line right there for advertising with this, or anything else. Because with retail, you know, you kind of get like a magazine review, like, for example, Game Informer, they'll be kind of like, well, I played this game before, and people paying $60 for this? I don't know, you know, kind of thing, and versus someone like picking up a game for like $5 to $10 on a digital distribution site like Steam and, you know, what have you. It's much more easy to access. It's easier to, you know, it's more affordable. And that's why I think what attracts people more to digital distribution nowadays than, you know, retail. I mean, I like retail like anybody else, but it's just, it costs a lot of money. I mean, especially for companies do all the advertising like you were mentioning, I just look at all of it and just go, jeez, you know. Because I hear about like the horror stories, like, for example, Splatterhouse. I heard that one didn't do very good at all. They advertised a lot out of it, but what happened was they were rushing it a little bit, and some of the product got kind of sidetracked. With digital, again, it's more of an even pace. You don't really rush too much, and it's easier to produce because, again, you'll have that open medium where you can see feedback and you can be able to communicate with the customer to a point.
Right. I think I caught most of what you said. You kind of cut out just a little bit. I don't know if it's on my end or not, but I get what you're saying. You know, the beauty of digital there's a lot of awesome points to this business model, and the future of games obviously looks to be going digital. I think I saw a report somewhere today that said digital sales will surpass retail sales like in 2013, which is just crazy to think that way. But a lot of we can control our own destiny. We can ship a game when it's done. We thought Pinball FX 2 was done 9 months before we released it, and we were like, wait a minute, we need to do just a bunch more work before this game's ready to go. And so we did, and I think that, it's paid off. That work definitely paid off. But if we were with a traditional publisher, they would have just said, nope, sorry, cut the code, Goldmaster, and off it goes.
Yeah. I really cannot stand that sometimes. Like, you'll see a game, you'd be really excited for it, and you just hear all these good things about it, and it gets released because it gets rushed by the suits that be. And again, I'm not going to bash EA or any of those companies, but sometimes they kind of push it way too soon because they're trying to meet the demand of the customer response and feedback way too much. And they just need to, like, sit back. Yeah.
You've got quarterly sales goals you got to hit. You've got boards of directors. You've got shareholders. You're a publicly traded company. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that, factors into those decisions, but it's much harder to stomach delays in games. Especially with small budget stuff. A big company like EA probably has huge overhead to make the same type of game that we're making with a small indie studio where we just don't have a massive company to support.
Yeah, like EA, for example, they'll just like blink twice and it's like, boop, instant product. You're like, what? Yeah. They'll have like there are three China shops working like overnight and the game would be done. You're like, what the heck happened?
And I just want to make sure whoever hears this, Zen Studios, like, we embrace our name as culture, like, we're Zen over here. Like, I'm not meaning to bash on anybody. I'm not trying to put anybody down, or that's not my intent. It's really just to say, tell another side of the story, and we're obviously close with the guys at Microsoft. We're happy with the work we've done with them. It kind of hurts to like just hear so much negativity about those guys, especially when you have personal relationships with them, and you just know how they're feeling when they read this stuff. And everybody makes mistakes at one point in time, but just to hear it constantly over and over, I was like, that's it, I have to say something.
Yeah, get let off that steam a little bit there, pardon the pun.
Yeah, exactly.
But, alright, you got anything else to say, sir?
No, it's weird hearing me referred to as sir.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm very, very formal.
It's all good. I'm super excited for this fall. I think there's a ton of great games coming out, and I wish I had more time to play them.
Very true. I mean, most of the games are coming out I cannot afford on a budget. I mean, I look at most of these games going, jeez. it's a little costly.
Yeah, you could spend a lot of money this fall, yeah.
Yeah, like you'll have Gears of War 3 coming out.
Like, week's release schedule is just crazy, right? With like Driver and Dead Island, Resistance 3, and then you got Blood Rain on download, and I mean, others. It's just like, oh my gosh.
Yeah, I'm doing a Home Alone scene there in the mirror going, ah! Kind of looking at all the lineup. I mean, it's a lot of good games. I just can't. I got to, like, slowly take my pace with it and just slowly, accumulate the funds to grab some of these games at some point. But,
I'm so far behind. You're going to laugh when I tell you this, but, I just started Mass Effect 2, like, 2 nights ago. And because, getting hyped for ME3, and I just never got in because of time. And really, when you work in the industry so much, you don't play kind of anything as much as you want. So I finally just made a point. I sat down, played ME1, and now on Mass Effect 2, and so I'm really looking forward to Mass Effect 3.
Yeah, believe it or not, actually, it was like a year and a half later when I actually bought Mass Effect 2 after I bought Part 1 off pre-owned. And I was playing it, I was kind of skeptic of the game, jumped right into it. I was like, oh, this is great, because I wasn't really, I'm not truly, behind the scenes, I'm really not heavy into like the Western RPGs too much, but this game kind of brought this whole perspective of just being, it's loose collared. It's not as, roll 20 die or something like that to do something. It was just straight up shoot something, and it's like, yes. Yeah, I can't wait for Emmy as well.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, no, I guess that's what I wanted to say. I don't know if you have any more questions for me, or if hopefully I got a point across and hopefully, you know, understood. I don't know. That's about it.
Well, no, I mean, other than the fact that, you know, you pretty much said everything I was about to ask, actually. You just kind of was like straightforward. You went boom and just I was like, all right, I'll have to ask that. And I was like checking it off. I don't have to ask that. I don't have to ask that. So.
Okay, cool.
Again, I'd like to thank Mel from Zen Studios for coming in here and speaking with me today. Again, this will be on thedailygamepad.com as well as featured on YouTube. So, again, thank you a lot, very much, sir, for coming on here and having a little chat with me. And sharing your...
Absolutely. Anytime, man. Anytime.
All right, folks. That is us signing off on a ship that looks something like the Mass Effect vehicle. But, yeah, copyright reasons, we can't quite call it that. Take it easy, folks.